On our return, the house smelled of green soap. Mom has washed the floors. Now she was turning her attention to the windowsills. Grandma was asleep in a chair nearby. Mom wrung the cloth over the bucket, straightened up, and looked at us. "Will you put some porridge on?" she said. "Yes, I can do that," Yngve said. "Are we going to put up the tree soon?" I said. "You can bring it on if you like," she said. "Where is it?" "Actually, I don't know," she said. "Ask Kjartan." I slipped my feet into a pair of much too small clogs and shuffled over to the other house, rang the bell, opened the door, shouted hello. No answer. I walked carefully up the stairs. He was leaning back in his restless chair and taking in the fjord. He had those big headphones on, tapping his foot to the music. Obviously, he hadn't heard me. If I walked into his line of vision, I would startle him. There was no other option, though. Shouting was no good. The music was too loud. I could hear it from where I was standing. I went back out. Grandpa was walking from the barn to the house. A cat sauntered along behind him. "Any luck?" Mom asked when I went back in. "He was busy," I said. "He was listening to music." Yngve sighed. "I'll go and see him," he said. 5 minutes later, he was wrestling with a large, straggly Christmas tree in the hallway. We screwed it into the rusty metal stand and then set about hanging decoration on it from a box Mom had located in the meantime. After we had eaten, I went for a stroll around the farm, over to the old, derelict mink sheds, down to the black mare, past the place where the beehives had been. Further on, by the remains of the foundations of the house that had once stood there, I smoked a cigarette. There wasn't a sound to be heard, nor a soul to be seen. I threw the stub into the wet grass and walked back to the house. My shoes glistened. In the downstairs bathroom, Mom was helping Grandma to take a shower. Yngve sat listening to Grandpa, who was bent forward on the sofa, his arms resting on his knees and chatting the way he always did. I plopped down in the other chair. Grandpa was talking about the time he had fished for herring in the 1920s with his father, how you could hit the jackpot with one cast of the net, and how that actually had happened once. His eyes gleamed as he recalled those times. He told us about the skipper who had stood in the bows as they approached Trondheim one evening, like a baying dog, he said laughing, because what he was baying for was women. He had spent a long time smartening himself up. Now he stood at the very front of the boat, sniffing the wind as they glided into the illuminated town. Then he talked about the time he had been the explosives boss on a road building project. In the evenings, they had played poker in the workman's hut, and he had won time and time and again. But he couldn't spend the money. He had to buy a wedding ring for Grandma and didn't want the money for it to come from gambling. So he kept putting all the money back in the pot and sat watching the sweat pouring from the other's foreheads. He laughed so much he had tears in his eyes as he described how the others had looked. And Yngve and I laughed too. Grandpa's laughter was so infectious it was impossible not to. He was bent double with laughter, unable to speak, and tears were streaming down his cheeks. But he not only entertained us with stories of the past, he wasn't given to nostalgia, for as soon as he had regained his composure, he started to tell about a trip he had made to America to visit his brother Magnus, about how he had sat alone in the night, zapping through the endless variety of channels Magnus had. It was incredible, a miracle, and I smiled because he couldn't speak English and understood nothing of what had been said as he sat there mesmerized in front of the television night after night. Yngve shot me a look and got up. "Are you coming for a breath of fresh air?" "Yes, you boys do that," Grandpa said, leaning back against the sofa. It was raining, and we stepped under the overhang by Kjartan's front door and lit up. "How is it going with Hanne then?" he said. "It's been a long time since you mentioned her." "It's going nowhere," I said. "We chat on the phone now and then, but it won't work. She doesn't want to go out with me." "I see," Yngve said. "Might just as well forget her then, eh?" "That's what I'm trying to do." He ground his heel into the soft gravel, stopped, looked across at the barn. It was falling to pieces. The paint was peeling off here and there, and the ramp to the hayloft was overgrown with grass. But even though the barn was decrepit, it still stood out because the background, the green meadows, the gray fjord, and the leaden gray sky somehow thrust it forward, somehow elevated it. Or else it was because the barn had been so important when I was young. It had been one of the most pivotal buildings in my young life. "By the way, I met a girl," Yngve said. "Really?" I said. He nodded. "In Bergen?" He shook his head, took such a deep drag his cheeks were hollow. "In Arendal, actually. It happened this summer. I haven't seen her since then, but we have exchanged letters, and I'm going to meet her on New Year's Eve." "Are you in love?" He eyeballed me. Such a direct question could go both ways. He didn't always want to talk about things like this, but he was in love, of course. He glowed in that peculiarly introverted way at any mention of her, and probably wanted to talk about her all the time. At least, if it was like me, he would, and he was. "Yes, basically," he said, "that's what it boils down to so few words, to one word, in fact. What does she look like then? How old is she? Where does she live? Can we start with her name? That's the most practical." "All right. Her name's Kristin." "Yes?" "She's 2 years younger than me. She lives on Tromøya. She's got blue eyes, blonde, curly hair. She's quite small. You went to the same school as her. She was in the class 2 years above you." "Kristin?" "Doesn't exactly ring any bells." "You'll recognize her when you see her." "You'll have to get together with her then." "That was the idea." He looked at me. "Why don't you come to the party? At the Vindelhytta cabin. If you're not going to another party, that is." "I don't have any special plans," I said. "Perhaps I should." "I'll be going anyway. Come with me." I nodded and looked away so that he wouldn't see how happy I was. We went back in. Grandpa was asleep with his chin resting on his chest and his arms folded. It was 5 o'clock. The Silver Boys was starting on TV. I went downstairs from my room dressed and ready. White shirt, black suit, black shoes. The whole house smelled of lamb. Grandma was wearing her finest dress and her hair was brushed. Grandpa was in a blue suit. Kjartan, a 1970s style gray suit. The table was set, a white cloth, the best dinner service, green napkins next to the plates. 4 bottles of beer, room temperature, the way it was drunk here, and a bottle of akavit in the middle. All that was missing was the food, which Yngve had gone to bring in. Grandpa had cooked it. "There are only 5 potatoes, Yngve said. "There isn't even enough for one each." "I can go without," Mom said. "Then you can have one each." "Even so," Yngve said. "One paltry potato for Christmas dinner." I helped him to carry in the dishes of food. Steaming lamb ribs, square pieces of roast pork with crackling, some with tiny bristles intact, mashed Swede, sauerkraut, red cabbage, 5 potatoes. The lamb was delicious. Grandpa has cured it, soaked it in water, and cooked it to perfection. The sole criticism of the meal, the most important in the year, was the lack of potatoes. You should never skimp on anything, and certainly not the potatoes. But I recovered from my disappointment, and no one else seemed to give it a thought. Grandma sat hunched over the table, trembling, but her mind was clear, her eyes was clear. She saw us, and she was pleased to have us there. I could see. Just the fact that we were there, that was enough for her, and always had been. Grandpa wolfed down the meat, his chin glistening with fat. Kjartan hadn't touched the food. He rambled on about Heidegger and Nietzsche, a poet called Hölderlin, and someone called Arne Ruste, to whom he had sent poems and who had made some kind comments. He mentioned several other names in his monologue, and all of them were spoken with the familiarity he seemed to assume everyone shared. When the meal was over, Ingvar and I carried the plates and dishes out while Mom whisked the cream for the rice pudding. Kjartan sat in silence alone with his parents. I suggest we institute a Heidegger-free zone, Ingvar said. Mom laughed. But it is quite interesting, she said. Perhaps not on Christmas Eve, I said. No, you're probably right there, she said. Shall we have the dessert a bit later, Ingvar said. I'm absolutely full. Me too, I said. The lamb was good this year. Yes, it was, Mom said. A bit salty though, maybe? No, Ingvar said. It was just right, it was perfect. So shall we start on the presents, I said. We could, Ingvar said. Will you do the honors? Okay. I was given an EP by Ingvar. The Dukes of Stratosphere, a sweater, and Vandrup's Bjørnebo biography by Mom, a torch by Kjartan, and a big slice of salmon by my grandparents, as well as a check for 200 kroner. I gave Mom a cassette of Vivaldi she could listen to in the car, Yngve the solo LP by Marty Wilson Piper, the guitarist in the church, Kjartan a novel by Jan Kjærstad. Yngve read out the names in a confident voice and distributed the presents with a firm hand. I scrunched up the wrapping paper, threw it into the roaring wood burner, and took occasional sips from the cognac Grandpa had brought in. Yngve passed him a present from Kjellaug and Magne's youngest daughter, Ingrid, born many years after her siblings. And when he opened it and saw what it was, he stiffened. Suddenly he was on his feet and heading for the wood burner. What did you get? Mom said. Don't throw it away. Grandpa opened the stove door. Mom hurried over. You can't burn it, she said, and took the present from him. Grandpa looked hostile and bewildered at the same time. Let me see, I said. What is it? It's a plaster cast of her hand, Mom said. The impression of a small hand in plaster, why would he want to burn that? Kjartan laughed. Johannes is superstitious, he said. It means death, that does. Yes, it does, Grandpa said. I don't want to see it. We'll put it in here then, Mom said, putting the plaster cast out of sight. She made it in the nursery and sent it to you. You can't throw it away, you know that. Grandpa said nothing. Was that a smile on Grandma's lips? Ingvar passed Kjartan a present from him, a bottle of wine. Bullseye, Kjartan said. He was sitting on a chair at the back of the room with a glass of cognac in his hand, wearing a milder, more conciliatory expression on his face now. Perhaps we could listen to our records on your stereo tomorrow, could we? I said. Yes, help yourself. Kjartan was sitting by the Christmas tree, which wasn't quite straight. It was leaning toward him. And then, while I was looking him in the eye, I saw on the margins of my vision that it had started to move. He turned his head. His eyes lit up in panic. The next second, the tree crashed down on top of him. Grandpa burst out in laughter. Yngve, Mom, and I laughed too. Kjartan jumped up from his chair. Yngve and I straightened the tree, screwed it into position again, and moved it against the wall. "Even the tree won't leave me in peace," Kjartan said, running a hand through his hair, and then sat down again. "Skål," Yngve said, "and Merry Christmas." After Christmas, we took the express boat to Bergen and flew from there to Kjevik. Mephisto, the cat, was ecstatic to see us when we arrived, almost clawing my trousers to pieces when I let him lie on my lap during supper. It was good to be home, and it was good to have Yngve there. The next day, he wanted to visit our grandparents on Dad's side. He hadn't seen them since the summer, and I went with him. Grandma beamed when she saw us standing on the doorstep. "Granddad was in his office," she said, as we were going upstairs, and Yngve immediately sat down in his chair. With him, the atmosphere with Grandma was not as humdrum as it was when I was there on my own. Yngve was much better at hitting the right tone in our family. He joked, made Grandma laugh, and had fun with her in a way that I would never be capable of, even if I practiced for 100 years. Suddenly, completely out of the blue, she looked at Yngve and asked him if he had bought something nice with the money. "What money?" he said. I flushed scarlet. "The money we gave you," Grandma said. "I haven't been given any money," Yngve said. I forgot to pass it on to you," I said. "Sorry." Grandma stared at me as if she couldn't believe her ears. "You didn't give it to him? I'm really sorry, I forgot. Did you spend it?" "Yes, but I only borrowed it. I was going to give him the money back in Sørbevåg, and then I forgot." She got up and went out. Yngve sent me a quizzical look. "We'll be given 100 kroner each," I said. "I simply forgot to give you yours. You'll get it later." Grandma came in with 100 kroner note in her hand and gave it to Yngve. "There we are," she said. "Now let's forget all about it." Yngve did, in fact, get together with Kristin on New Year's Eve. I saw it all. From the moment they met and she looked up at him with her head tilted and a smile. He had said something and seemed strangely shy. I laughed inwardly. He was in love. Afterward, they didn't talk, but they did cast occasional glances at each other. Suddenly, they were sitting opposite each other at a long wooden table. Yngve was talking to Trond. She was talking to one of her friends. They sent each other furtive looks. Still talking. Then Yngve got up and was gone for a short while, sat back down, continued to chat with Trond, picked up a slip of paper and a pen, wrote something. And then he pushed the slip of paper over to Kristin. She looked at him, looked at the piece of paper, and read what he had written. Looked at him, pinched her thumb and first finger together several times, and he passed her the pen. She wrote something, pushed the sheet across, he read it, got up and went over to her, and then suddenly they were immersed in deep conversation. There were only the two of them in the room, and the next time I saw them, they were kissing. He had managed it. After that evening, for him, everything was about Kristin. He went to Bergen on January the 2nd, and the house felt empty. But only for a day or two until I was used to it. And life continued as it had before, with its minor developments in one direction or another. All the unforeseen events that fill our lives, some of which lead to a locked door or a deserted room, while others might have consequences that only come to fruition many years later. I started doing local radio with Espen. We broadcast one program a week. It was live, and the basic format was that we played records by our favorite bands and talked about them. I told everyone I knew they should listen, and many of them did. No one then. It was not uncommon for people at school or on the bus to comment on something we had said or some of the music we had chosen. Radio 1 was a small station. There were not many listeners on a normal weekday evening. And Nye Sørlandet, which I wrote in, was not a big newspaper, but between them, they gave me a sense that I was on my way. The radio program meant that I had to stay in town after school. There was no point going home, turning around, and going back. And I made it a habit to pop in to see Grandma and Granddad. They were a safer bet than Dad for food. And I also avoided the uncertainty that a visit to Dad entailed. Would he ask me in or not? Would it be too much for him or not? After these long evenings in town, having dinner with my grandparents first, then meeting Espen at the radio station, planning the program with him, and then doing it, I would get on the bus and listen to music the whole weary way home, including the last kilometer, locked inside myself, hardly noticing the white world I was passing through until I removed my headset, opened the door, untied my boots, hung up my jacket, and went into the kitchen to have a bite of supper. Mom was on the first floor watching TV. When she heard me, she switched it off and came down. "Did you hear it?" I said. "Yes," she said. "Was it embarrassing when we got the giggles, or was it okay?" "No, it wasn't embarrassing, just funny, Karl Ove. Grandma rang while you were out." "Oh?" "Yes, it wasn't a pleasant conversation, I'm afraid. She said, well, she said you weren't to go there anymore. She said you never had anything to eat whenever you turned up. You were shabbily dressed and were always asking them for money." "What?" I said. "Yes," Mom said. "She said it was my job to look after you and not theirs. It was my responsibility. So no, they don't want you to go there." I started crying. I couldn't help myself. The tears came with such force. I turned away from her, my face contorted into ugly grimaces. I covered it with my hands, and even though I didn't want to, I sobbed. I took a saucepan from the cupboard and filled it with water. "This has nothing to do with you," Mom said. "You have to understand that. This is about me. It's me they want to hurt." I put the pan on the stove, barely able to see through all the tears, raised my hand in front of my face again, bowed my head. Another loud sob rolled out. She was wrong. I knew that. This was about me. I had been there, I had physically felt all the silences and all the unease I carried with me, and in a way I understood them. But I said nothing. The convulsive twitches in my face let up. I took a few deep breaths, wiped my eyes with the sleeve of my sweater, sat down on a chair. Mom didn't move. "I'm so angry," she said. "I don't think I've ever been so angry before." "You're their grandchild. It's difficult for you now. It is their duty to support you, no matter what." "It isn't difficult," I said. "I'm fine." "You have hardly anyone around you. The few people you have cannot turn their backs on you." "I'm absolutely fine," I said. "Don't give it a second thought. I'll manage fine without them." "I'm sure you will," Mom said. "But they're turning their backs on their own grandchild. Can you imagine? No wonder your father struggles." "You don't think he's behind it then?" I said. She looked at me. I had never seen her so furious before. Her eyes were blazing. "No, I truly don't." "Well, not unless he has changed totally in these last 6 months." "He has," I said. "He's a completely different person." She sat down. "And there is one more thing," I said, "that you don't know. Yngve and I were given 100 kroner each for Christmas. I was supposed to pass the money on to Yngve, but I spent it. Afterward, I forgot all about it. When we were there over Christmas, it all came out." "But Karl Ove," Mom said with a sigh, "even if you had stolen the money, that's no reason for them to turn their backs on you. It's not up to them to punish you." You got to understand, I said. It's obvious they were angry. And what grandma said is right. I eat whenever I'm there, and they give me money for the bus. You've done nothing wrong, don't even think it, she said. But I did, of course. I lay awake for the first hours of the night as the cold took a grip on the countryside and caused the timber walls of the house and the ice in the river below to creak. Then, in the darkness, I was able to see the matter in a colder, clearer light. If they didn't want to see me, well, then they wouldn't see me. I hadn't gone to visit them for my benefit. I lost nothing by staying away. And there was a sweetness in my decision never to see them again. Not even when they lay on the deathbeds would I go and see them. Indeed, even when they had died and were about to be buried, even then I wouldn't go and see them. Unlike Dad, who during my childhood years had boycotted them for periods, cut off all contact for a month or two, only to resume relations as though nothing had happened. No, I would stand firm. I would never see them again. I would never talk to them again. If that was how they wanted it, that is how they would get it. I didn't need Grandma or Granddad. They were the ones who needed me. And if they didn't understand that, well, good luck to them. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. That was wonderful. I wanted to, you know, you've said in your books and in interviews that you have a very unusually bad memory.
Yeah. But you, but this was kind of a very unusual Christmas. You have the tree falling, I mean, and now it's like this. I remember that landscape. That landscape is inside of me, you know, and it's the same with every landscape. I think I remember all the rooms I've been in my entire life. So I have a kind of visual memory. And when I write, I just go in there with my thoughts, you know, and there they are, the persons, and something happens. And then I have these memories, the things I knew of, you know, with the tree falling, or with it throwing in that thing. And that's kind of the things I maneuver towards and then leaves behind, and then something else comes up, and I start to remember, you know.
And so you do remember more as you're writing.
Yeah, very much so. It's like it's, especially with the childhood book, book three, I didn't remember very much from my childhood. I have these kind of iconic memories, but that but is what is, maybe 10, 15. And when I started to write, that's the opening of the book, I'm writing about that. I don't remember so much from my childhood. And so I didn't know more than the reader at that point. And then, in some way, I get a hold of the physicality of being 8 years old. I mean, that physical presence you have in the world. You're running a lot, you know, and you're climbing trees, and you are... it's all kinds of sensation that you relate to. And when I discovered that, it was easy to write, because when I kind of find my inner 10-year-old person and started to explore the world from his perspective. And that was the important thing, the feeling of being 10, much more than the details. And it kind of, the one thing gave the next, you know? So it was a strange experience. And now I have forgotten it, and I haven't read the book since then, and it's kind of, it's closed.
I mean, the way you describe the way you're writing brings up the sense of how much control you have over the project. And I was wondering if you could just talk to us a little bit about, you. As far as I understand, you didn't set out to write a 3,500 page book. So could you tell a little bit how that happened?
Yeah.
What you started with and...
Yeah. I wanted to write a book about my father and my father's death. That was the novel. And I tried to do that for 4 or 5 years, I think, not succeeding at all. So I was so desperate that I could do anything for a novel. And then, out of frustration, I started to try to write it just as it was, you know. And then that attitude, the things that were wrong with the previous things I've been writing was that it was like I was displaying something. You look at this, this is how it happened. But I didn't manage to evoke the presence in it. So it was like it was fake. It was like I was making something up, and I didn't want to make anything up. So therefore, I started to write very quickly. I had this rule of 5 pages each day. And I have 4 children. Then I had 3 children. And it was like this, when I have to get them at the nursery, and if I have only written 3 pages and it was 1 hour left, I had to produce those 2 pages in that hour. And that makes a kind of a pressure on you, and it still makes it impossible to think and to reflect. You just have to do it and trust your intuition. And then I wrote this book that way, and I just continued because I had this kind of language for the things that's outside of the narrative, but it's very important in our lives, the boring things, you know, the stuff outside the drama. So I wrote another book, and for me that was just one book. And then it was 1,200 pages, and I gave it to my editor, and we were discussing how we should publish it.
You gave it in one unit?
Yeah, 1,200 pages, one book. and we were discussing how to publish it. Should we divide it into 2 books, and should we publish one that year, one the next year? And then the head of the publishing house heard of this, and he called me, and he said, we'll publish it as 12 books, in 1 year, one each month. And you're a writer, you know how fantastic something like that is. I mean, it's very a very creative way of thinking. And then I could choose, should I divide that book into 12? We ended up with 6, because I didn't want to lose so much money, so it was 6 books. Should I divide it into 6, or should I divide this into 2, which is naturally was, and then write 4 more during that year. And we said we are going for that. So we, while we were publishing book 1, I was writing book 3, editing book 2, doing interviews, all those kind of things, and then writing book 4, and then book 5. And then I even wrote book 6, but within a year, while this was going on. But book 6 was fake. I had got reaction from book 1 and 2 when I was writing book 6, so I knew what people liked and didn't like, and I kind of tuned myself into it and presented myself in a fake way. So that
I look forward to meeting the fake.
Now that fake didn't, we didn't publish it.
You redid it.
1 year later, book 6 came. So the project failed. But the interesting thing was that this was kind of an interaction between writing and life, and people were reading about themselves. And I got all these things back while I was writing. So that was very intense and very interesting. So it turned out to be more like an experiment. And it was very dangerous. Felt like it was very, very dangerous, because you can't control the reaction of other people while you're doing something like this. So it could end in a disaster, but it didn't. I hope it's still something
still
can
time.
Happen. Yeah, it is.
Yeah. But you were really not in control. Not just that you hadn't finished the book, but sometimes when I read your book, and part of what I love about it is I don't feel that the person writing knew where the book was going to land. And I even sometimes get the horrible pleasure where I think when they wrote this, they being you, he didn't know what it would feel like. He just let it go and figured out what it would feel like later. I mean, did your books surprise you, especially the first 2 volumes, which you really wrote in the dark?
Yeah. If the book surprised me, or the reaction?
I guess what I mean is, were you surprised by the books that other people read compared to the book that you wrote? You know, like that kind of gap. Like certain things probably stuck out to readers that didn't stick out to you, or people must have been offended or pleased in ways that maybe you didn't foresee.
Yeah. Yeah, I wrote it almost locked in a room, and I didn't think of the consequences or the possibility of what these books could do in no way. So I was aware of that it is problematic to write about people who lives, you know. So I sent out the first manuscript to everybody I wrote about. And then kind of all hell broke loose. Then I understood what this was, because they were so angry. I mean, it was really, they wanted to stop the book. They called it, you know, they called the publishing house, wanted it to stop it. And I never expected that. And then there was all kind of other reactions that I didn't. Because what it is, I'm just saying very normal things about people. But there is something with a book, and it is something with literature, and it is something with the presentation of other that is so so strong. And you know, even insignificant things, if you write it, the impression it's such a big thing. And if you write, you are by yourself. I don't see that clearly. I have a kind of autistic thing in me. I managed to be attached from everything, everybody. And I think every writer has that ability. And you have to have it if you want to write something of importance, I think. But no, I didn't know of those kind of reactions. And I thought maybe this is a Norwegian thing, maybe there's a bit sensitive to it because of, you know, there's a culture there, you are not supposed to reveal very much about yourself. It's kind of, to be very private is very good in Norway. But then I wrote a piece for the New York Times, and I'm mentioning some people there, here, and very innocently, and they were, you know, they were angry, and what are you? So this is a global thing, I think. It's to be written about is very hard.
Well, I was thinking about in the New York Times piece, there are details that are very innocent. Like you say, for example, you travel with a photographer who's young and who it seems like you and him get along quite well, and you write about him in a very, I don't know if it's a generous way or not, because I don't know who he is, but in, you know, a seemingly loving way. But I could imagine, as I was reading it, I felt a sort of fear at several moments. And one is where you just have this moment where you're talking to the photographer and he checks something on his phone, which everyone does all the time. There's nothing particularly damning about it, but I just thought, well, if that was me, I would be ashamed for the next 2 years.
Yeah. Yeah.
I wanted to read in this book 4, which, you know, if I was trying to sell this book to a larger market, which it doesn't need, I would say it's like 530 pages of trying to lose your virginity, which I think is a great hook. But there's this wonderful moment where you're at school and the teacher hands out slips of paper and everyone's supposed to write 3 personal qualities they have on the slip of paper. And you write down somber, torpid, and serious.
it's still like that, you know?
So you that hasn't changed.
No, it hasn't.
And you seem to me, based on like reading your books, I mean, you seem easily mortified and easily ashamed. Even in the New York Times piece, there's a moment where actually everything goes really well. Everything's quite awkward for the trip. You don't have your driver's license. You're sort of stuck in Newfoundland for a few days. You don't really want to talk to anyone. And then one night, you sort of go, you play darts with a photographer. Someone in the bar has like a distant Norwegian relative, and they're thrilled to talk to you. You're warm, you're open, you're loving.
And drunk.
And drunk. Everyone's happy, nothing bad happens, although it seems that you maybe black out. And the next morning, instead of thinking, I finally had an American experience, I have something to put on my pee, or I had a good time, whatever it might be, you just think, that was the worst possible.
Yeah.
And so how does that not inhibit your writing because you're so present on the page.
Yeah, but it does. It's like I have to develop methods to be able to write because I'm so ashamed of what's on the page, you know? And one method is, I mean, to try to be, as I said, clever or to try to write very, very well, because that protects you, you know? So what I really should have been was an academic, because the protection there is so massive. You can't fail. But it is a language there. It's based upon you're not making a fool out of yourself. Nobody's going to laugh about this if you write it like this way. And you train to write things like this way. It's very safe. And you say very good things there, but it still is safe. In a novel, you don't have that, you know? And when I was doing this, I didn't have that safety net of cleverness because I was so direct. So what I had was, I had a friend. I was reading every page of this book to him on the phone every day. He devoted kind of 2 years of his life to listen to me and to the book, and this is true. I mean, this is, and he said, you know, this is good, go on. You don't like it, but it is good, go on. And then I have my editor, and he's saying, this is good, go on. And then I can do it. Without them, I really can't do it because it's, I'm so ashamed of it. And if it opens up and just read it, shame. And then you have this reaction, massive, you know, the good criticism, the warmth I get, all these things. And it's great, but it doesn't fit in with the way I see it, you know? So it's a kind of a contradiction. And it's like it is based upon something. But still, I know what it is at the same time. But you know, this, we are talking about feelings, emotions. And on an emotional level, that's how it is. It feels like it's fake in a way or something wrong here.
And also it seems like the constraint of time and not being allowed to kind of worry over your sentences and words also liberated you.
Yeah. And it is one of Anne McEwen, who's coming here, I heard. I watched an interview with him, and he said one of the, you know, the one joys of writing, which every writer knows, that could happen, I mean, once, so it can happen every year, but that's a feeling of selflessness. You lose yourself in the writing. And that's a very good word for it. That's also a shameless state of mind, of course. So if you go there, it's just to write, and it's afterwards the shame comes. And it is a bit like drinking. You know, I really love to drink because I'm free, no restriction. I do what I really want to do, say what I really want to say, you know, and it's the same in writing. I'm free. And then when you wake up, when the writing is over, I'm full of shame, full of shame. And it is the same, it's different. But I've been thinking about this. My father must have had something of that in him. And he drank and he died of drinking. And I read his diaries, and he was in a therapy place for alcoholics, and one of the things he was supposed to do was to write a diary. And he wrote about being lonely and loneliness, and like an essay about being lonely. And I, you know, you have your father, you don't imagine he could be lonely. Fathers are not lonely, but he was lonely, and he was drinking. And I think it was just another way of making a solution to that problem. And writing is a much more constructive and good way to deal with it, but it is related. There is something destructive also in writing and in giving yourself away in writing, you know? It is.
I know that you didn't write about your father to necessarily learn something about your father, but did he sort of change as a character in your kind of mental landscape as you wrote about him? Because certainly as a reader, you kind of go through a lot of walls and you kind of, I anyways, as a reader, even though he's quite harsh on you, I kind of loved him. I felt he was a very vulnerable and emotional man. I mean, did he sort of, even though he has already died, so often in this book, you remind us that someone's dead right before you describe them. And even the characters who are all still alive seem like ghosts kind of briefly manifesting. Did he just kind of change as a ghost when you'd spend so much time thinking about him and writing about him?
Yeah, I did. Especially maybe when I wrote about my childhood, because I only have the perspective of a child looking at him. But now I was writing about him, and I was even older than he was then, you know. And I could see the whole picture. I could see the whole family and the dynamic in the family. I didn't know there was such a thing as a dynamic in a family, and you don't do when you're a child. But I saw a lot of things in him. And also, by publishing these books, people sent me letters who knew him, his colleagues, saying, you know, I have to say your father, he was, you know, good, or he was much better than you do you present him. But that was for them.
Right.
And then I met one of his colleagues, and he told me that your father often talked about, you know, episode from his childhood, and he was tortured by, you know, those kind of things. And I didn't know this. It was new to me, you know. And so all this book is, he's changed a lot for me during the writing of this book. And it could be also just the fact that I'm older, you know, and a father myself, and so on. But I like the good thing about writing so many pages is that it is, you can allow yourself to present a person in many, many different ways through our life. So my father is one person when I'm 10, one person when I'm 20, and one person now. But it's still, you know, he wasn't a good father, you can't say that. But he was my father. And I'm almost not mentioned in the diary. It's like I didn't exist. My brother, he didn't really care, you know? And if you have a father who don't care, then I don't see you, then that's a big negative force in your life. And I think it's often that simple, you know? Then you want to be seen, basically. Or you kind of deal with it and become mature and a grown-up. But I have kind of retained that in me. So I wrote a novel, my first novel. And I thought I wrote it for myself. But my father died when I finished it, before it was published. And I realized I wrote it to him. I wanted him to see me. That was the reason, because the novel felt completely meaningless, you know?
Once he wasn't there to witness it.
Yeah.
I was going to ask some of the questions of the audience.
Yeah.
Wrote down. One person says, what do you think of New York City?
Yeah, it's like this. When I come to New York, there is so many things that's going on. I'm supposed to having such a good time, and that makes me very confused. And the three first times I've been here, I basically go to my hotel room, watch TV, eat chocolate. That's
what
I do.
That sounds good.
Yeah, it is. But now when I come back now, people take me on to places, and what the fantastic thing is all the people I meet, you know, and that's the great thing. And that's New York, it's people. When I live, it's no people, just landscapes. Here it's no landscape, only people.
Someone asks, you read at McNally Jackson once, and someone asked you a question about the sadness in your books. You said, I am a miserable man. Everyone laughed. It didn't seem like you meant it as a joke. How did it feel bearing a truth and having it be so misinterpreted?
The last one.
How did it feel bearing a truth and having it be so misinterpreted?
I think that's the irony of this, what's happening with these books, is that it's so much a reflection of inner life, you know? That's what it is. There's no outside in these books, it's only inside, you know? And the way, when we're doing this, it's only outside, you know? And it's picture, images, interviews, photos, it's the opposite. And it's, I find it interesting. to be a part of something like that, because it's such an essential part of our time, these two ways of communicating. I mean, the visual thing and what it is to be famous or recognized or all those kind of things. All the faces we relate to, we don't know them, but they are there, you know. And this book, which is literature is very intimate. It's only one person and a book, and that's it. And the way you can communicate is above every other medium you can communicate within a book, just because it's one person. And when you read, it's like you have to submit to the book, you know. It's like you have to, and you have the book inside of you. And that's the inner life. There you can communicate that, and that's what I'm doing. So when I'm saying something like that, everybody who reads the book knows that, you know. And it's not funny when you read it. It could be funny, of course, but not in that way.
Right.
It's like you can identify with it, and you can think all kind of things. But when you say it like here, I'm miserable, you know, then it's funny, and it's something completely different.
I mean, someone writes, you spoke in your books about longing to be famous as a child, and how does your experience of fame compare to your fantasy?
When I was a kid, I think almost everybody wants to be famous when they are kids. But it never occurred to me that it should be problematic. That I didn't know of. I thought it's a purely good thing. But it is a good thing to be recognized for what you're doing, in that there's so many doors that opens, you know. That's an amazing thing. And be able to travel with the books. I would lie if I said I don't like that. I mean, it's really brilliant.
Someone says, I read in an interview that you were planning to call your autobiography Argentina.
Yeah.
As an Argentinian, I was wondering, first, is that true? And secondly, why would you have named it that way? Thank you.
Yeah, I can understand why someone from Argentina found that hard to believe. But it is like this. When I was a kid, I was very interested in football. And the first World Cup I can remember was from Argentina. And it was like a dream, you know. It was those stadiums, the colors in the 70s, confetti. It was like magic. And then I started to read. And then there was a magic in Borges, Cortázar, those amazing, brilliant writers, you know. And then I saw images of the landscapes. And the culture is partly a bit Spanish in there, of course. And it's like a dream continent. It's like a dream land. And it's like, I know, it's all the thing I'm longing for. It looks like here, but it's not here. It's much better, you know. And that's the longing in the book goes towards such a place. And that's why I wanted to call it Argentina. But it is, if I'd done that, I think nobody would have paid any attention to the book.
Someone asks, I think this will be our last question, how does it feel to read in English and what are we missing?
An English translation? I haven't never read it, you know, completely. I've only read excerpts like this. So this part I've never read before I read it to you. And that's very exciting for me, because I have written this and it's my grandparents and my environments, and I'm reading it in English. And I find it absolutely superb. It's like it is my grandparents. This is like it's there. And I think that was the most important thing in a translation is, you know, the atmosphere of it, which Don Bartlett does brilliantly. And all the excerpt I have been reading has been like that. I recognize it and I feel this is right, this is right. It's not right in details always, but you know, the impression of it.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.